what are the landmarks we'd be looking for? We'd be looking for landmarks such as the external oblique ridge, mylohyoid ridge, both of which are radiopaque. Then we would go in further downwards into the submandibular fossa. What one expects a student to do by the end of this lecture is to be able to label or at least interpret which are the landmarks, key landmarks in the mandible. There are a lot of landmarks which are difficult to for a student to understand or grasp in the initial attempt, but at least the basic ones the student is expected to know by the end of this lecture. For the mandible, we would start off from the posterior region rather than the anterior region. And the two landmarks which you are looking at are radiopaque. They run almost to the neck of the molar there. The other one is also a radiopaque landmark, but slightly below the first one. You can make a guess of what these two landmarks are. We will discuss it in the next slide. In this slide, they have given a description of what the two landmarks are. The first one, the one on top, is actually the external oblique ridge. The one on the lower side is in fact the mylohyoid ridge. The mylohyoid ridge, remember, is the area where the mylohyoid muscle, which basically forms the musculature of the floor of the mouth, is attached. The external oblique ridge, in fact, gives the strength to the mandible at an area where it is more susceptible, the area where ramus and the body of the mandible join. In this particular slide, we see a radiolucent area which is basically in the shape of a hockey stick. This radiolucent area starts from the posterior part of the mandible, is actually linear and has a curve before it opens to another radiolucent area in between the two premolars. Any guess at what this landmark is? You will find the answer in the next slide. Now here there is a description of what these two landmarks are. The landmark which is radiolucent and runs down along the body of the mandible on the lower side is in fact the mandibular canal, and then takes a loop and opens into the mental foramen. So this is a very important landmark when you are dealing with any of the dental or tooth structures in the lower jaw. I was talking about the inferior alveolar canal. Now here is one variation of the inferior alveolar canal. If you look at the ramus area, you find a whitish circle trying to show you something interesting. Here the inferior alveolar canal actually has got a bifid root, and one passage goes straight into the anterior border of the ramus, the other passage runs a normal route. This particular radiograph tells you a very important fact regarding the inferior alveolar canal. Remember, the roots of a molar, especially the third molar, can be placed on the buccal aspect of the canal, can be within the canal, or can be placed on the lingual aspect of the canal. In any situation, the periodontal ligament space surrounding the root of the molar or the third molar appears to have widened when it is overlapped by the canal. So this is very important fact to remember, especially when you are viewing the roots of a third molar and trying to find out its relation with the inferior alveolar canal. In this particular radiograph, you see a radiolucent landmark close to the apex of a premolar. This becomes very important if there is a cavity or a radiolucency in the crown of the premolar, which would indicate the presence of a pathology. But otherwise, there is a key landmark which is present in this area. What is this key landmark is discussed in the next slide. The landmark we were talking about is in fact the mental foramen. This is circular and usually placed in between the root apex of the two premolar. Often it is in close proximity to the second premolar than the first premolar. You also have a gross specimen to show you the exact location of the mental foramen. In this particular mandibular anterior occlusal radiograph, you are seeing two spike-like radiopaque masses on the lingual side. What could be this radiopaque spike-like masses? The answer is present in the very next slide. These radiopaque masses are in fact the genial tubercles. Usually they are four in number. The attachment of some of the important muscles such as genio hyoid and genio glossus arise from this particular area. That is why on an occlusal radiograph in the anterior region, you tend to see these radiopaque landmarks. Here we have an interesting radiograph. You see a hazy kind of radio opacity near the middle third of the roots of canine and the two premolars. Any guess at what it could be? The answer is present in the next slide. If you have taken a guess, mandibular tori is the right answer. In fact, there are two of them in this particular picture. Usually they do not cast any sort of shadow on a radiograph, but at times you have seen them create a radiopaque area, especially in the middle third of the roots of the premolar and the canine. Here again, we have three anterior IOPAs covering from canine to canine. And if you see carefully, there is a radiolucent area in the middle third and the lower third of the root. What could be this particular landmark? We will discuss it in the very next slide. This particular landmark is the mental fossa, a depressed area of bone lying in between the incisors on top and the lower border of the mandible below. So this particular depression in the mandible gives rise to the radiolucency, making it look like a pathology when viewed in certain anterior radiograph. Any guess at what these radiolucent landmarks are? To find the answer, click on to the next slide. Here we have a radiograph showing very interesting features. You see radiolucent lines running down from the middle third region of the alveolar bone to further downwards. What could these landmarks be? They are in fact the nutrient canals. These canals are prominent in certain conditions such as hypertensive patients, calcium deficiency and advanced periodontal disease. If we carefully observe this mandibular anterior radiograph, there are radiopaque areas on either side starting from the midline. What are these bilateral radiopaque areas? They are the indications of mental ridge. Ridge is any prominent bony linear area on the skeletal system. And these ridges usually tend to appear as radiopaque lines. In the final part of this lecture, it is also important to know what is the typical trabecular pattern or what is the pattern of the cancellous bone. Whether it is the maxilla or the mandible, they have their characteristic bone pattern. We will look into the bone patterns in the next two slides. We'll first look into the mandible, where the trabeculae are arranged almost parallel to each other in the posterior region. Many of the experts felt that it looked like a stepladder, and it has popularly gained the name stepladder pattern. This is very characteristic in the mandibular posterior region. Mandible, the maxilla shows a granular pattern of the bone. This is characteristic and distributed throughout the anterior and the posterior region of the maxilla. To get a detailed idea about the landmarks, make sure that you go through the text.